are the potter. We are the work of your hands. Isaiah 64, verse 8. While I stand on this stage alone, it took much more than just me to arrive at this place in my journey today. While each of us, myself included, may feel that we are alone at times and pioneering our paths alone, we are the accumulation of countless influences, guidance, and loves. Our lives constantly reflect the work of the potter's hands, and we are never in this life alone. I came here today to share my story with you, my past, my struggles, my victories, and my faith. For it is in sharing our stories with one another that we find encouragement and become inspired. As a little girl, Sunday mornings were never a guest to me. I never questioned where I would come Sunday morning or what I would be doing. My family life was centered around church, around worship, and I think that is something that I may have taken for granted. While living at home with my parents, my relationship with God was something that was built in, maybe even something that was expected. I remember whenever I wanted to go out on Saturday night, my parents would always tell me, no matter what time you come in, you're going to church on Sunday. It was never a question where I would be, even if I was tired. When I graduated from high school, I started making big plans. Plans to leave home, become independent, go to college, and begin a whole new life. As those plans began to unfold, I came to realize just how important my walk with God was. I also realized how much harder nurturing my relationship with God was than before. I didn't have someone to get me out of bed to go to church on Sunday, or I didn't have anyone to remind me to pray anymore. And my search for godly friends wasn't easy. It was a choice I had to make daily, to wake up each morning in thankfulness and try to live my day following Christ. While college was an amazing experience that brought me new friends, expanded my mind, opened up opportunities, and brought me closer to God, it didn't come without struggles and anxiety. These obstacles were each year, but the bulk of my obstacles began arriving in my final year of my undergraduate degree. Those who know me know that I'm a planner. I plan everything. I plan trips, I plan my life, and I do it in detail. But as I mentioned earlier, our lives are shaped by the potter's hands and not our own.
Amen.
His ways are greater than our ways and his thoughts are higher than our thoughts. So while I imagine myself smoothly skating through my senior year full of fun, laughter, trips, and memories, I found myself in the midst of a crisis. The crisis began when I started my career search. I didn't expect to find and land the perfect job on my first try, but in the back of my mind, I did. I felt that my resume was extensive and I've done enough work to get a job. I found out that the job market was more than just difficult. So I started applying for jobs a year before my graduation date. I started off with 10 jobs, then 20, then 50, and within a span of 6 months, I applied to over 500 jobs. I interviewed with more than 20 different companies, but after my work and each interview, I would receive a letter or email that began with, "We appreciate your interest. We decided to move forward with a more qualified candidate," rather than congratulations. This was the point in my life where I felt discouragement every single day. I always thought to myself, had I done something wrong? Was this not God's plan for me? I started to think maybe it was God's plan for me to come back to Greenville to get on my feet. And that wasn't his plan. The plans I had so carefully laid out for my life were shattering, but I made a decision to trust God's plan. I began trusting him more and praying more. Many people continuously told me to trust God even though I was becoming discouraged. And then, 14 days before walking across the stage of my college graduation, I received the call. The call that I have been praying and waiting for the past 2 months of interviewing. I was in the process of walking into an interview with the hospital in Winston-Salem when I received a call from Epicor Healthcare. When I answered, she said, "Hey Madeline, I know you flew down for your final interview last week. I just wanted to follow up with you to see how it went." When she asked me that question, I was thinking she was just trying to make conversation before she told me they went with another candidate. We talked about the interview and how it went, and then she made a long pause and goes on to say, "Well, the manager, Sean, loved you and would like to offer you the position as a business analyst in Hilton Head, South Carolina."
Amen.
And she told me that I could start whenever I would like. I accepted the job, but then I went right in an interview, and the whole time I was in the interview, I wasn't paying attention. Through the disappointment and pain, I realized something even more than a job. Once I trusted God with my journey, I began to understand that having a strong foundation in faith is the most important thing you can possess. Faith without works is dead, and I was putting in the work, but I was lacking in faith. More important than a job, more than being liked, having fame, or possessing money, a relationship with God is the only way to know the true definition of happiness. Something I think people misconceive so often is that if something is meant to be, then everything will fall into place and be easy. I have found that philosophy to be so far from the truth. I think Jesus himself sent on the most divine mission of all time to sacrifice his own life. His journey here on earth was far from easy. Scorned, forsaken, mocked, and rejected. However, there is no doubt that his mission was meant to be. That sacrifice was a part of God's plan. Just because your journey isn't going how you planned doesn't mean you aren't following God's plan. Just because things aren't easy doesn't mean the prize isn't worthwhile. So today, I would like to leave you with four challenges. The first challenge is a challenge of passion. I implore you to find out what you're truly passionate about in the world and use that passion to make a difference. Life is too short to spend your days doing something you don't love.
Amen.
The second is determination. It's not enough to just set a goal. You have to see it through, and to do that, you can't let anyone or anything stand in the way. You have to push yourself beyond what is comfortable, beyond what is expected to become the person God made you to be. The third is the ability to listen. We spend so much of our time talking or planning what we're going to say next. We never just pause, breathe, and listen. Become someone who is known to be a good listener, not a good talker. The fourth is self-awareness. Know yourself. Don't allow titles, social media, trends, or even your friends to define who you are. Identify your strengths and use them to help others. Know your weaknesses and make them stronger. To the youth, I have been where you are, at a crossroads where you see the goal in front of you, but the path is unsure. You are making plans, envisioning the future, and getting excited for what's to come. But always remember who you are. Always remember that you were His. As millennials in today's society, we tend to view everything as a competition. We compare ourselves to our friends on almost everything, and sometimes to people we don't even know. Doubting yourself and comparing yourself to others shows a lack of faith in God's plan. He made each of us different for a reason. He made each of our journeys unique and special. Choose faith over doubt. Choose prayer over worry. Believe in Him and His plan, and He will guide you every step you take. Yet you, Lord, are our Father. We are the clay, you are the potter. We are the work of your hands. Isaiah 64, verse 8. To Reverend Speed, Ms. Cassandra, officers and visitors, thank you for having me here today.